I'm very happy to introduce our next speaker, who is well known to all of you as well. We are very fortunate to have Dr. Nicole Lurie, who's the Assistant Secretary for Preparedness and Response at DHHS. She's had a distinguished career and most recently was directing RAND's public health and preparedness work at the Center for Population Health and Health Disparities. And she has had quite a job on her hands since arriving right at the beginning of the H1N1 crisis and has been, I think, absolutely consumed and critical for the nation in the response to H1N1. So we're very happy that you could join us today and take the time for this conference.
Tom, thanks so much. I am so excited to see such a thoughtful group of people here today to take on the issue of resilience. I'm very excited and enthusiastic about the concept, but even more excited about us moving from concept to reality. As many of you know, our office is finalizing the first ever national health security strategy, and clearly promoting community resilience is one of its major goals. Some of you know I also had the opportunity to work on the national health security strategy before coming to ASPR. And so while it's been a part of the strategy from the get-go, I want to say that some of my ideas about how to promote it actually changed partway through. And I'm going to ask those of you who have heard me talk about this before to forgive me. But for me, my experience on Election Day last year actually really sort of transformed some of my own thinking about community resilience and how to get there. So I thought I might just share that with you very briefly. So probably like many other people, I just took the day off to work to get out the vote, and I went to Philadelphia, where I'd gone to college and medical school, and where I'd been 4 years before, and there had been so much voter intimidation in the precinct that I'd been in that I just decided I needed to go back there. So I went back, I got up early in the morning, I went out to where I'd been 4 years ago, and the campaign headquarters was in a vacant storefront. And I walked in, and someone at the front had a name tag on it, said in charge. And they directed me somewhere else, and there was somebody who had a name tag that said operations, another person who had a name tag that said logistics, another person with a name tag that said administrative issues. Sound familiar? Then over to the side, there was volunteer training. And you had to go through volunteer training before they let you go out on the street. And I will say people were streaming in from everywhere. Lawyers from New York, doctors like me from Washington, people from the neighborhood. It was just really pretty amazing. And so they handled these volunteers in groups of about 30. And you went and you sat and you got some basic orientation to what you're supposed to do for about 15 minutes. And then you went over to the administration area and you got a packet with names and a little map of where you're supposed to go, knock on doors and remind people to vote. And all day long, people just kept streaming in off the streets in large numbers wanting to help. And I think they accommodated every one of those volunteers. So after my first time out on the street, it was reasonably clear to me that I walked faster than most of my buddies, and so I started going alone. But a couple things really struck me. First of all, school was out, and so were these roving groups of mostly teenagers, some kind of older people, I couldn't really tell how old they were, you know, out on the street, and they would be yelling at me, following me, "Obama, Obama, can I have your button? Can I have your name tag? Can I have a picture? Can I do whatever?" But more amazingly is like they followed me around all day long. And at certain points, I would go up to different groups and I would ask the older among them, like, "Did you vote?" Because I couldn't tell how old they were. And I'd get these sheepish looks like, "No, I'm too young. But, you know, I got my mama there, or my auntie, or my sister, or my uncle, or my neighbor. I'm making sure that they get there today." I'd start to walk up, you know, four-foot walk-ups. And the first thing that was amazing is people would knock on the doors. I mean, people would open the doors when you knock. That usually doesn't happen in North Philadelphia. And people would open the door, and some would say, "Of course I voted," or, "No, I'm going to vote later." Or The person next door is not home right now. Well, when do they usually get home? Well, around 3. Well, if they come home around 3, you could save me a trip back if you could take responsibility for reminding them about voting. Yes, I'll do that. Don't bother going next door. Nobody lives there anymore. It was really pretty remarkable. And block after block after block, it was like this. At one point, I was sharing with somebody, a Laotian guy showed up and said, nobody in this block speaks English. I'm going to come with you. Just kind of out of the blue. You know, they've been following around, waiting. So many times when people would open the door, they would say things to me like, you mean my name is on a list? Show me my name's on a list. You mean somebody knows that I'm here? Somebody cares about me? And it was really remarkable to me. At one point in the afternoon, I walked into a bar because I wanted to see television. And there were a bunch of guys at the bar doing what they usually do. When the bartender gave me a really nasty look, I tapped the first one on the shoulder, and he pulled out his I voted sticker. And then person by person by person down the line, everybody voted. Same at the laundromat. Same with the homeless drunks that I met on the street. It was really amazing. And about 4 o'clock, I called back to some of my colleagues at RAND, and I said, you know, I've had this really interesting experience. I spent today at a pod. And in this pod, they delivered something to every household in Philadelphia or in their district 3 times within 8 hours. So do we need to rethink some of our concepts of the way we do this? It was kind of interesting. And then driving home that night, more than anything, I was sort of struck. And it really hit me. I said, you know, these are people who in public health we say are hard to reach. And yet we reach them. And they did something that they have never done before, many of them, in their entire lives. They voted. Granted, it was a single action. Granted, it was on a single day. Granted, for many, it was a set of very unique circumstances. But I would submit to you that there are lessons from that that we need to take to think about how we motivate people to action and fundamentally about how we get to resilient communities. So, and I'll talk more about that in a bit, but as we talk about building resilient communities and what that means, or for that matter, what it means to engage people or reach hard to reach people are different. Just like the term public health emergency preparedness when we started, I think that we could squander a tremendous opportunity to move forward if we don't get into alignment about what it is that we mean. So I'm actually really having very high hopes for this conference because I think it is an opportunity for leaders in this field to get into alignment about what it is that we mean and then to make some real progress finding a way forward together. So what do I mean? Let me say straight out that I think of resilience as something much more than the ability to get the right countermeasure in people's mouths or arms or noses or whatever within 48 hours. Obviously, we know that resilient communities and resilient people have a much better chance of withstanding and recovering from any kind of catastrophe. We also tend to lump these issues about people and these issues about communities together when we think about how to get there. I'm not sure that's quite right, but I would love to hear what all of you think about that after today. But we also know that decreasing vulnerability, which is key to increasing resilience and recovery, has aspects that are in common for individuals and communities. And I think identifying what those are also really important. So I've been asking myself, so what does resilience look like? And how would I know it if I saw it? Because I think I've got to be able to answer that question if I'm going to help our office and our nation get there. So let me take a little bit of stab at it, and you can add to it. First, that both individuals and families and communities know how and are able to care for themselves in both routine and emergency situations. In this country, we talk a lot about individual responsibility, and we've been harping on that for a really long time. The last time I was in government, I had the privilege of working on healthy people. And in healthy people, we very much embrace the Evans and Stoddart model of what creates health. So that in addition to genetics and environment, individuals are nested in and conditioned by their communities. And that, in turn, is very heavily influenced by a set of policies, and somewhat, in the health aspects, dependent partly but not entirely on access to care as well as other things. Since Healthy People, I think we've learned a whole lot more about the basic science of some of this. Early wiring and early childhood experiences are terribly important, so a bunch of emphasis on resilience in children is really warranted. Biology is not destiny, but biology can be changed, or biological expression of one's genetic endowment can be changed and is changed by experiences, both good and bad, and also conditioned by the neighborhoods in which one lives. And most importantly, I think that the ties between people and with people in communities play a really critically important role in all of this. So on the individual level, I would think that individuals have to have the education and skills they need to receive and act on information. There need to be basically enough of their daily needs met so that they actually could plan ahead and actually care enough to do so. That they know, from a health perspective, they know their medical problems, the important health behaviors they need to engage in, and from an emergency preparedness point of view, also their medications. They have what they need to shelter in place or to be able to evacuate, including food, water, et cetera, supplies. They have adequate physical fitness or mobility to be able to do that if they need to. Again, if they have chronic illness, they need somehow to be able to access their medical records remotely. They're psychologically healthy and resilient, and they can constructively adapt to get on with their lives after some big change. They know people who depend on them and who they depend on for care and support in an emergency. I think that's really important. And they take responsibility, obviously, for their own actions and assist others to do the same. Put their own mask on, and then put the mask on the child sitting next to you. From a community level, I think it looks somewhat similar, but not identical. Certainly, communities need to ensure the conditions in which people can be healthy. That's just straight out public health. Easier said than done. We can create environments which are safer and have some kinds of redundancies in them. I know there's going to be a session after this on designing safer hometowns out of harm's way and those kinds of things. You can ensure access to a health home for all residents and a system that provides needed care and medicine in crisis situations. Again, including remotely, and many new developments suggest that we ought to be able to do a lot of this in untraditional ways. Resilient communities build social cohesion. And as I said, we know so much more about the importance of this now. I think in a resilient community, every person would have at least three other people who would know where they were and how to reach them. I think Rich was just talking about this in some important ways. And what their health needs might be in an emergency situation so they can help them get what is needed. By the same token, every person would have maybe three other people that they could depend on. Don't necessarily have to be next door neighbors or even in their families. You know, healthy communities and resilient communities would support a whole host of healthy behaviors, including preparedness behaviors. And frankly, that they would create a culture where people in the community are prepared to respond and help other people in distress, frankly, day to day, as well as in an emergency. So if you look at models for this, they're all over the place. Bystander CPR and response. Things that the National Disaster Medical System does in its communities. The provision of psychological first aid, which many neighbors have learned to do for other neighbors in places like New Orleans. Basic citizen training in areas at risk, in things like urban search and rescue, which are frankly the norms in places like Cuba and Mozambique, places that are just in harm's way from a weather point of view. What we don't know is sort of what is the tipping point in any community for how many and what kinds of people you need to have there? What is a critical mass? And how do we get there so that when faced with an adversity, a community can sort of best able to start to take care of itself? I don't think we're anywhere near there yet. And just as a small anecdote, and I know I shared with some of my colleagues my frustration with this, not long ago, I got on a plane to fly to Europe, and in the middle of the flight, you know, they asked for a doctor on the plane. I was with a number of physician colleagues. I was like the only person that got up to help the person who went down in the bathroom. That is not resilience, folks. We have to help create a climate, whether it's a legal environment or a cultural norm, in which people just don't sit there and watch other people in distress. And I think we have to create a culture in which others, individuals and communities, near and far, reach out to others that can help them recover. And know that how first responders, the media, and ordinary citizens treat one another early on is going to have a huge amount to do with recovery. One quick point about recovery that I want to make is that we often talk about recovery as getting people back to where they were. Just want to say that many people started in really crummy situations. And the most vulnerable and least resilient usually start in the crummiest situations. So I'm not sure that the goal ought to be to get them back to where they were. The goal's got to be to get them, hopefully, somewhere better. So far, this whole set of efforts about preparedness and response, resilience, a national effort. And I think, as you were just hearing from Rich and others, to engage citizens and, by implication, really communities. This isn't a new idea. You know, community organizing, community policing, fire safety campaigns, community-based participatory research, some kinds of public health campaigns, teaching children to teach their parents. These are all kinds of things that have been done for a long time. Some political campaigns, including the one I just mentioned, attempt to do this in one form or another. So I think there are a lot of lessons learned and some things to build on. But some thoughts and some takeaways for me from my most recent experience, and this was, you know, first of all, clearly getting people galvanized around a common goal is really, really important. Connecting people to one another is critical. You know, this campaign did this in all kinds of amazing ways, with house parties, organizing on the internet, having people call 10 strangers who they never called before halfway around the country. Many of them developed interesting friendships that way and engaged in conversation. It was kind of interesting. And they developed communities, frankly, across time and space and kinds of ways of connecting to people that I don't think many people ever really imagined before. We need to give people bite-sized actions that they can accomplish, like calling 10 people, as opposed to, you know, going and giving up your job for 6 months or a year, which many people did. That's, for many people, not as bite-sized an action as picking up the phone for half an hour and calling 10 people or whatever it is. Something they can accomplish, something that they can be successful at, and single initiatives they can take. And then for those who want to get more involved, and there should be a whole culture that creates that, there has to be a pathway to further engagement, successive steps that they can take. One question I have coming out of this whole experience is whether some new technologies can play an important role in this community building and building resilience. So all of these next generation web technologies are really designed for participation, and they can allow communications in many directions between many different kinds of people, between people in communities, between people across communities, among strangers who don't know each other, and we see this happening both for good and for not so good all the time on the internet, but it hasn't necessarily been harnessed for these kinds of purposes, and between government entities and the public. Clearly, social networking technologies are changing the way that people exchange information and engage with one another. And I am wondering how, by taking advantage of some of this, we might seek to reach out to different people and engage them where they are and where they are ready to take action, rather than requiring them to come to some place or do something else. And this, frankly, includes people that we think of as the most vulnerable. I am increasingly amazed at the fact that the digital divide is narrowing fast. I practice medicine in a community clinic with all underserved populations. All of them have figured out how to access the internet one way or another, whether it's in the waiting room of the clinic or in a library or at home. And that's largely because the younger generation is so connected, and because the younger generation sort of now does it on cell phones. This isn't really a uniquely American thing. I mean, we all watch, I think, with sort of amazement, what is going on in Iran with text messages, right? And you see that all kinds of movements that engage people can happen with new technologies, again, across time and space, but ways that connect people to each other, help them take action, help them become more resilient. And so for us, for government now, and for people who do preparedness and health for a living, I have a lot of questions about how we can harness this, not only with the healthcare system and electronic medical records and telehealth and all of those kinds of things, but in something really new and different to help create more resilient communities. Obviously, the healthcare system plays an important role in community resilience, especially in the aftermath of a disaster. And I'm sure that one of the things you'll be talking about today is what a resilient 21st century healthcare system really needs to look like. And I want to stress, I don't think it's necessarily redundant. I think it's something else, because I think redundancy causes a lot of inefficiency and waste. That's something we're trying hard, I think, right now to address. And so I'd really appreciate a lot of your ideas about how to do that. Finally, back to the National Health Security Strategy. It's a national strategy, not just a federal gun. So what is the most constructive role for the federal government to play in promoting this kind of engagement and this kind of resilience? How do we engage the private sector? How do we engage the nonprofit sector? How do we engage the media much more constructively in promoting resilience? In the end, every resilient community is going to look a little different, and approaches to resilience within communities across the country will undoubtedly be as diverse as the communities themselves. But I get back to, well, how am I going to know it when I see it? And I want to be able to measure it, because ultimately what gets measured gets done, and so I think because measurement is key to improvement, and if we're really going to build resilience, we've got to be able to measure it. We've got to be able to see how it is that we are tracking our progress. So I'm hoping that another one of the things that this conference might produce is some innovative thinking, not only about how to define it, but how to measure it. So I hope that these thoughts and these questions will contribute to a constructive conversation today. I very much look forward to continuing to be a part of this conversation as it continues into the future. And since I've been so immersed in H1N1 and just listened to Rich's New Year's resolution, resolve to get vaccinated. There's finally enough vaccine out there for everybody, and it's time. Thanks. You know, it's, I think, in the realm of community resilience, if you look across HHS and federal government, there are all kinds of things sort of all over the place in these little pockets. And I pointed to community-based participatory research as an important one, and some research in defining resilience as others, and some kinds of pilot projects that exist in a lot of communities, many, I think, focused around recovery. I think we need to bring them together. We need to identify what some best practices are. And I think we need to focus as a laser right now on what it is that we mean. For many, building community resilience means getting our countermeasures enterprise really robust. And that's a really important thing to do. And as we've watched from our current H1N1 adventure, it's not only enough to get that stuff made and developed, but we gotta find ways to make it acceptable to people and get it in people's arms and noses, right? And if you've got a countermeasure that 50% of the people don't want or trust, because they don't trust government or because of some other reasons, it doesn't really do you any good. So the countermeasures enterprise is really important, and it starts with the basic science, but it ends with that person whose life is saved by that. I don't want to, it's a critical part of the resilience effort, and it's a place where we're spending a lot of time and energy and money, but that's not all there is to this.
Well, on that, here's another question. 12 months from now, magic wand in hand, are there three things that you think we should have accomplished to further resilience?
We got to define it. We got to have some measures, and we got to know where the lowest hanging fruit is for us to be able to take some action. And we have to try some things that are bold and innovative. That's four.
Some quasi-breaking news from yesterday. President Obama announced yesterday $500 million for community health centers and $55 million for health IT. Is any of this going to be leveraged for resilience in the national strategy context or other?
You know, it's a really great question. And we've been having a lot of very active discussions, particularly with folks in the office of the National Coordinator for HIT, about this whole huge investment in health IT and what it means for public health. And it's kind of an interesting thing, because if we think about where this is all going in the healthcare system, there's a lot of innovation, and there's also a sense that the market demand and need for new software technologies, new kinds of approaches to using and leveraging health ITs is really going to drive innovation and demand. I wish that there was that kind of demand in public health and in community resilience. I'm not sure it's there, and I'm not sure many who really work in this field and need to work in this field even have a good enough sense of what is possible to be able to create that demand if they had the budgets to do it. So one of the things that we're talking a lot about is, what does advanced development for this kind of stuff look like? And how does the advanced development frame that we think about for countermeasures help us think in a much smaller way, because I don't think it's anywhere near as expensive as developing an anthrax vaccine, to develop some really innovative applications. I think, frankly, we started to harness some of those current have been doing really innovative things with things like MedMap, just to wed public health information, population health information, healthcare information together, so that when we have to respond in a community, we know who's there, what their needs are, what resources are there, what languages people speak, et cetera. It's pretty basic, but it's I think, a start at bringing these various streams together.
Okay, I have another question here about some specifics. Someone identified water as a critical. The questioner doesn't believe that water, or lack of potable water, kind of plays into community resiliency planning at the federal level sufficiently.
Yeah, well, that's a good question. I'm glad they said healthcare sector, not healthcare system, since we don't have one yet. But I think certainly many resilience, I mean, many preparedness plans at an individual, at a community, at a healthcare facility level understand the central importance of water. And certainly communities and their planning would be really remiss if that wasn't a really important part of what they do.
I think I have time for one more question here. Has your perspective changed in any substantial way going from analyzing public health preparedness from the outside and more at the state and local level to now being at the federal execution level? Did your vision of public health preparedness change, or any surprises?
Well, I mean, I think it's fair to say, I mean, and it's been a great opportunity to walk into this job, you know, in the middle of H1N1. I missed the spring wave from inside government, so I got there in mid-June. But it's been really an amazing kind of experience. An amazing experience to see what's worked and what hasn't. You know, when you're as close to it as many of us are, the sausage making's really ugly. When you stand back and you say, could you have imagined when this started that we would really have 80 million doses out on the street now? I think most of us would have thought that that was really a dream and not a reality. And yet there have been obviously many hiccups along the way that have taught us a lot, that inform sort of where we have to go, you know, again, with sort of all the sort of planning about countermeasures and manufacturing and all of that. At the other end, we see how incredibly stressed public health is on the ground, and what an amazing job so many people are doing, frankly, out of sheer dedication. Many working nights and weekends without budgets, many laid off people still coming to work to get this kind of stuff done. It's really pretty amazing, but that's not a sustainable system. today's Wall Street Journal, I think, had an article on all the different kinds of things health departments can't do while they're doing H1N1. That's not a surprise to me, but one of the challenges I think we have ahead of us there is at the end of the day, just like we don't have a shared understanding of what resilience is, our nation still doesn't have a shared understanding of what public health is and what health departments do and what they should expect from them. And my big fear now is they're going to say, oh, those are the guys that do vaccination clinics, but have no other understanding of what it is and does. And I think that's a really huge risk and a place where I think we all need to be working going forward. The other just quick comments I would say is I've been amazed at the way all the fighting factions of the healthcare system have come together to get on goal and on mission with this. And I think it's given us a lot of understanding about how further to prepare the healthcare system for more catastrophic stuff. I'm happy to talk about that some other time.
Well, Nikki, thank you so much. And good luck in your work ahead.
Thanks.
We'll be supportive as we can.